running from your call. Running from your call. Jonah, the entire first chapter, verses 1 through 17, talk about his disobedience and running from the call of God on his life to go and preach repentance to the city of Nineveh. When God called Jonah to go to Nineveh, Nineveh was actually due east of where he was in what we would call modern-day Israel. It was more inland, but he chose to go west towards the shore, and he caught a boat to go farther west, exactly the opposite direction. It's possibly, why did he disobey and go the opposite direction? Possibly because Jonah was afraid that the Ninevites might indeed repent and thus experience God's grace and forgiveness, something that he could have felt they should not receive. Now, are you and I very different? Aren't there certain folk we'd rather they didn't come to the grace of God, or that they didn't receive the blessings of God the way they are receiving them, or the way we receive them? So, Jonah went, watch this, the number of downs. He went down from the hills of Galilee, and you can read all this in chapter 1 as you study. From the hills of Galilee, he went down to the plain. From the plain, he went down to the harbor. From the harbor, he went into the ship. And from the ship, he went into the lowest part, or the depths of the ship. And it didn't even stop there. From the ship, or the lowest part of the ship, he was cast overboard into the sea, which is the Mediterranean Sea. And then, from the Mediterranean Sea, God caused a large fish or whale to swallow him, which took him into the depths of the sea. When we walk in disobedience to what God has called us to, we go down, 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 and down. Think of it. The only man on that ship who knew the truth. Now, there's a big storm, right? That's why they threw him overboard and then it calmed down. He was the only man on the ship who knew the truth. The only man who had the answer. All the pagans, the shipmen, the crew, including the captain, the Bible says they prayed and cried out to their gods, but not Jonah. Wow. The man of God, yourself listening, if you're a Christian, man or woman of God, in this case, the man of God, while they were praying, the man of God was fast asleep in the boat. Many a Christian will avoid the call of God by maybe sleeping hours on end each day, or by being involved in some other wasteful activity which is time-consuming, some other diversion. The world outside is dying, and the world is crying out to us. The sailors came to Jonah. They had prayed. They were afraid they would die, and they cried out to Jonah, "Get up! Wake up! Do something! Help us! Save us!" They asked Jonah, and today the world is asking you and me, my friend. Jonah had the answer. If you, like me, know the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior, we have the answer. The world is asking us today, who are you? They asked Jonah. What are you? Where are you from? What is your city? Who are your people? What God do you serve? If so, then cry out to your God to save us. So now we need to face those questions. Do we really know who we are in Christ Jesus and all that he has done for us? Do we know what our standing is before him, that he is our sovereign Lord and Savior and King, and we are his children, heirs and joint heirs with Jesus? Do we know where we are positionally seated with him in heavenly places? They, that's the ship's crew, know, and their actions acknowledge that their gods, with a small g, They know and acknowledge their gods are ineffective and impotent, powerless to save them. When push comes to shove, the unsaved world turns to us Christians, believers in Jesus, believers in the one true, living, risen Savior and God. They are calling out to us, crying out to us, help us, save us, deliver us, pray for us, cry out to your God for us. Not only, sadly, are millions of believers in Christ asleep on the job, so to speak, many of us are running from the call of God on our lives like Jonah, still flirting with sin, living in disobedience. Compare Jonah's incident with Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 through 27, and I shall read these. Now Jesus got into a boat, his disciples followed him, and suddenly a great tempest or a storm arose on the sea, so the boat was covered with waves, and Jesus was asleep. Get some parallels here. Then the disciples came to Jesus and shook him up, woke him, saying, "Lord, save us. Don't you care that we perish?" But he said to them, "Why are you fearful, O you of little faith?" Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. So the men of the disciples, believers in Jesus, marveled, saying, "What manner of man is he? Even the winds and the waves obey him. The elements are subject to his word." Hallelujah. There are some powerful parallels to the disciples in the storm while Jesus was asleep in their boat. Only in this case, it was the other way around. Remember, the ship's crew with Jonah were unregenerate, non-believers in Jehovah God. But here we have the disciples of Jesus Christ, believers in the living God, disciples just like us, those who claim to be Christians, followers of Jesus. The disciples' current situation was but an opportunity to test and ultimately build their faith, to demonstrate God's awesome power, and to unveil for them a glimpse of Christ's divinity. But the view of the disciples was very similar to that of the unregenerate ship's crew. They came to Jonah, "Get up! What are you doing sleeping? We're all gonna die! Come on, can you do something? Cry out to your God!" They came to Jesus, "Lord, don't you care that we perish? How can you be asleep at a time like this?" Now that's really rich, considering they had known the Lord Jesus, seen him in action, watched him personally, and experienced his miracles numerous times. You may ask, "But Brother Andrew, what else could you expect the disciples to do given the circumstances?" Here's a response to that question. At least they could have prayed and asked God to quell and quiet the storm first. Hear me, believer, this applies to you and I. At least we could have prayed first. Then we could maybe excuse them coming to Jesus. James 5, verse 13 says, "Is any among you sick or in trouble, experiencing any difficulty? Let him or her pray." Philippians 4, 6 is so powerful and applicable. "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving let your requests be made known to God." That's Philippians 4, 6. "But in everything by prayer and supplication let your requests be made known to God." But, no, just like many of us, the disciples at that point were panic-stricken, would be fair to say, and for us, perhaps self-absorbed, and I dare say, we even have a percentage of lazy Christians. We are not even willing to try. Our attitude is, "I can't do it. You do it for me." Doesn't that sound just like a child's response? I can't do it. You help me, you do it for me. It's worth noting that up to this point, the disciples in the boat in the storm had done everything but pray. They had probably tried everything, but they had not prayed. How different are you and I? We often strive and strive in the flesh, in our own strength, and only when we come up short and become desperate, we turn to Jesus. So, friend, don't be a Jonah. Obey God's call on your life. I shared before, I'll share it again. The word obedience has 9 letters. OBEDIENCE. 9 letters, but the middle letters are die. We don't want to die to ourselves. We don't want to die to the flesh. And so we are not being obedient in following God's call on our lives. There's a song that I somehow cannot find a really good rendition on YouTube or on the internet. There's one or two, but I'll just do a few lines because it goes right along with this incident. We compare Jonah with Jesus in the boat. This is with the disciples in the boat. Master, the tempest is raging, the billows are tossing high. The sky is o'ershadowed with blackness, no shelter or help is nigh. Carest thou not that we perish? How canst thou lie asleep, when each moment so madly is threatening, a grave in the angry deep? The Lord awakes and says, the winds and the waves shall obey my will. Peace be still, peace be still. Whether the wrath of the storm-tossed sea, or demons or men, or whatever may be, no waters can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace be still, peace be still. They all shall sweetly obey my will. Peace, peace, be still. Dear friend, whatever challenge you're facing tonight, take it to the Lord in prayer. And please don't run from the call of God in your life. If you have in disobedience before, let the Holy Spirit call upon him. He will embolden you to do a 180-degree turnaround and follow his high and holy call on your life. Don't be a Jonah. If you are blessed and challenged by this, would you subscribe, hit the notification bell, like, share, and comment below? Thank you and God bless you.